Welcome to Pilgrim's Progress. I'm Ray Greenlee, pastor of the National Prayer Chapel. Reading from this wonderful book, Pilgrim's Progress, by John Bunyan, edited by C.J. Lovick, let's review again what he saw as he was walking down the path, the narrow path. He saw two men come tumbling over the wall on the left side and onto the path. They immediately came toward Christian. The name of the one was Formalist. The name of the other was Hypocrisy. Soon they were walking with Christian on the path. Christian immediately began to engage them in conversation. Christian asked, "Gentlemen, where did you come from and where are you going?" Yesterday, right after the broadcast, a call came into the studio that I took. It was a man who asked me a question. The question was, "Do you believe in eternal security?" I answered the question, "Absolutely no. I do not believe in eternal security." And he said to me, "Then you are not saved and you are on your way to hell." Well, I didn't respond very well. I've had to repent of that. It struck me as such an insane question and such an insane conversation. Let me tell you why. The question you ask is absolutely vital. Had he asked me the question, "Pastor Ray, have you been crucified with Christ?" I would have answered, "Absolutely. Yes. Have you been crucified with Christ?" And we would have had a very productive conversation. Or had he said to me, "Pastor, where have you come from? What background do you have that has caused you to take the strong stand you have for righteousness?" We would have had a wonderful conversation. If you'd said to me, "Do you believe in the secret rapture?" I would have answered, "Absolutely no," and we would have had another insane conversation. Questions are of utmost importance because they reveal the heart. This man was obviously a cousin, a very close cousin of Formalist. He lives by his dogma and his doctrine. He cares nothing about whether a man is born again. He cares nothing about whether a man has died and been crucified with Christ. And frankly, that's all I'm interested in. And so our conversation had no basis in sanity. There was no possible way we could begin to exchange with any kind of brotherhood. He called me Brother Ray. We were not brothers. We were strangers. We were not able to communicate with each other. Now, part of that was also my fault because I wasn't very curious with him. It's not helpful for me to ask him, "How can you possibly believe such nonsense? How can you possibly believe in the wickedness of John Calvin and the whole Reformed movement? It is simply not of the Lord." Well, that wasn't very helpful for me to say either, and so I've had to eat humble pie and repent over that. But I want to talk with men and women about the real issues of life. I don't want to talk about the dogma. I don't want to talk about the hard-edged beliefs that have nothing to do with a man or woman's actual life. I'm not going to get into theological mud-throwing contests. That's not what this broadcast is about. It's not what my life is about. For me, life is much too precious to spend it arguing about theology. I have a journey to take. And you have a journey to take, and we have a destination we want to arrive at. And we're not going to be helped toward that destination by hard-edged, judgmental dogma. It's simply not going to help us in the journey. What's going to help us in the journey, I believe, and that's why I come to this broadcast, I come asking you questions. Have you been crucified with Christ? Are you walking in any known sin before God? Are you innocent before God? Has the blood of Jesus restored you? Has it taken your life and reshaped it into the image of Jesus? Where are you in the pilgrimage? Where are you in the journey? To me, the questions that John Bunyan asks are of such vital importance. And by the way, this may surprise you. John Bunyan, in 1668, when this book was published, was of the Reformed Baptist Church. He was a Reformed Baptist believer. And some of his theology I disagree with a bit, but it doesn't block me from enjoying the wonderful gospel that he proclaims about Jesus, because he was not caught in dogma. He was caught in love with this man, Jesus. So, if you want to grow in Jesus, if your heart is to ask searching questions about your walk with Jesus or my walk with Jesus, I welcome you to call me and we'll talk on the air or we'll talk off the air. But I'm not interested in a theological mud fight. I find the hard-edged attitude that says, I have the truth, I know the truth, and you're going to hell, I don't find that helpful. I find that very destructive. I guess my distaste for that came out of my early childhood upbringing. I was raised by a mother and father who were very devout Seventh-day Adventists. And they believed that they had the truth, and that anyone who did not believe as they believed was on their way to hell. I remember riding with my father. He was a very godly man, but he was quite expressive about his opinions. I remember driving by a church one Sunday and the parking lot was full, and my dad just casually said to me, Ray, do you see all those people? They're receiving the mark of the beast and they're going to be sent to hell. Well, I was shocked by what my father said. And as I grew older, and as I was a pastor for some years as a Seventh-day Adventist, I found more and more that I could no longer deal with that hard-edged, arrogant attitude that said, I have the truth, and if you don't believe what I tell you, you're going to hell. I just couldn't walk in that anymore, especially when I read the scriptures, and I was devoted to reading the scriptures. And as I read the word, I found the love of Jesus Christ. And I found that that love of Jesus was there for me to heal me and restore me. It was there to give me victory over all sin. It was there to wash me and make me clean. I found that obedience to Jesus was a great pleasure. Not because of some rigid dogma, not because of some fear of going to hell, but simply because I discovered how much he loved me. And I pray today that as I share this message with you, that your heart will be quickened by the understanding that God does love you. He does not love you unconditionally. He does not love you permissively. He loves you unfailingly. That's what the word says. He loves you so much that he opened for you a way of escape from the trap of your sin, not by some cheap profession of faith, not by praying some foolish sinner's prayer and saying, now I'm saved, but rather by giving you a way by which you could be crucified and the old man could die and you could be made new into the likeness of Jesus and you could be filled with the love of Jesus Christ. You could be overflowing with his grace that teaches us to say no to ungodliness. Now let's be very, very plain. This is a narrow path we've been called to walk. And there are some hills and some mountains that are going to be very difficult to climb up and over. But the love of Jesus sustains us. The confidence we have in the power of his blood to make us righteous, not to cover over sin and leave us in our mess, as the Reformed Church believes. That would not be good news for me. Don't tell me I have to sin until I die, that I can never leave my sin. Don't tell me that the blood of Jesus has no more power than the blood of bulls and goats, lambs and turtle doves. Don't tell me that lie. That's not what the scriptures teach. The good news is that the blood of Jesus, in its wondrous power, removes all bondages of sin from my heart and my life, so that there's no longer a desire in my spirit to rise up in rebellion against the Most High God. He writes his law in my heart, so that as I'm doing my natural will, I'm doing the will of God, because I'm a new creature in Christ Jesus. I've been transformed into his likeness. I'm like Jesus. He dwells in me. He lives in me. Is this good news to you? If it is, call me and let me know. The number here in the studio is 877-534-0780. That number again is 877-534-0780. Is your heart as hungry as mine is to make this journey successfully, so that we can walk in the presence of Jesus, that we could know him and be filled with his glory? Is that exciting for you? I tell you, everything else is boring to me. Everything the world has to offer, the lust of the flesh, the pride of life, everything the world has to offer is simply boring to me. It doesn't taste good in my mouth anymore. I have been ruined for the world because I've been prepared for the kingdom that is to come. I'm an alien. I'm a stranger here. I love America, but it's not my home. My home is heaven. I sometimes kiddingly tell people, they say to me, what's your address, Pastor? And they're serious and they're going to write down my address. And I tell them my address is New Jerusalem, street address Revelation 21. That's where I live. And they look at me like I'm kind of crazy. And I'm just playing. But do you hear what I'm saying? The joy of serving Jesus Christ exceeds the joy in every other area. Now, the Christian life can be quite miserable, especially if we keep putting our face in doors that Jesus is slamming shut. That's not fun. But when we learn to follow Jesus, we learn to trust him, and we no longer put ourselves forward as somebody. We are submitted to Jesus, and when he closes the door, we don't try to put our face in it and get it slammed. He opens doors that no man can close, and he closes doors that no man can open. So today, what questions are you asking? Are you asking those hard-edged, dogmatic questions that reveal the wickedness of your heart? Do you believe in? Do you? No, come on. The questions that are of most importance Tell me, are you walking clean before Jesus? Are you filled with the Holy Spirit? Have you been born again? Have you been crucified with Christ? And now does Christ Jesus live in you? What kind of questions are you asking? I want to read a bit further for you today. I find that the conversation that took place between Christian and formalist and hypocrisy was very telling. And today we have many who are formalists and hypocrites. And they want to focus on those theological questions that really don't matter to Jesus. So they came to the hill of difficulty, and I want to share this. I looked and saw Christian go up the hill, where I noticed him slowing his pace. He was no longer running, he was now walking, and finally just scrambling up the path on his hands and knees because it was very steep. Now I saw that about halfway up the hill there was a pleasant arbor built by the Lord of the hill for the refreshment of the weary travelers. When Christian reached the spot, he sat down to rest. Then he pulled his scroll out from under his coat and was comforted by what he read. As he entertained the pleasant thoughts about the changes that had taken place in his life, he at last fell into a slumber and then finally into a deep sleep. He didn't awaken until it was almost night, and the scroll had fallen out of his hand. Now, as he was sleeping, someone came to him and awakened him and said, "Go to the ant, O sluggard. Consider her ways and be wise." And with this, Christian sprang up and he sped on his way. He'd not traveled far when he came to the top of the hill. Now at the top of the hill, two men came running to meet him. The name of one was Timorous, or Timid, and the other was Mistrust, to whom Christian said, "Sirs, what's the matter? You're running the wrong way." And Timorous answered that they were going to the city of Zion and had climbed up the hill of difficulty. But he added, "The further we went, the more danger we encountered. So we turned around and are going back from where we came." "Yes," said Mistrust, "for just ahead there are a couple of lions in the way, and we don't know if they're asleep or awake, but we're sure that if we came within their reach, they would pull us to pieces." And Christian said, "You're making me afraid. Where shall I run to be safe? If I go back to my own country, which is prepared for fire and brimstone, I shall certainly perish. If I can get back to the celestial city, I'm sure to be safe. I must go forward. To go back is nothing but death. To go forward is fear of death and life everlasting beyond it. I will go forward." So Mistrust and Timorous ran down the hill, but Christian went on his way. But thinking again of what he had just heard from the men, he felt in his coat for his scroll so that he might read it and be comforted. But it was not there. Then Christian was in great distress. He didn't know what to do. He wanted to be comforted by the words in the scroll and also knew it was his pass into the celestial city. Now I want you to notice, Bunyan is indicating that this man, by going to sleep, remember this is an allegory, so going to sleep would mean that his eyes have turned from the journey, and he's now focused on the world. He's gone to sleep spiritually. And so his attention is now focused on other things, and he has literally become unconscious. And in the process, he has lost the prized treasure of the assurance of his salvation. So now he stood still and he became very perplexed. He didn't know what to do. At last he remembered that he had slept in the arbor and that it was on the side of the hill. Now what did he do? He fell down upon his knees and he asked God's forgiveness for his foolish act and then went back to look for his scroll. In other words, he immediately repented for falling to sleep in his spiritual life and focusing on the world. And now he has a journey he must take, but it is not a journey forward toward heaven. It is a journey backward where his repentance must be proven that he could be reestablished in his assurance of his salvation. All the way back he went, and there was great sorrow in Christian's heart. Sometimes he sighed, sometimes he wept. Sometimes he chided himself for being so foolish as to fall asleep in that place. It had only been erected for a little refreshment for the weary. So he went all the way to the arbor, carefully looking on this side and on that, hoping that he might find the scroll that had been such a comfort to him on his journey. Finally, he came within sight of the arbor where he had previously sat and slept. The sight of the place renewed his sorrow as he remembered again how wrong he had been to fall asleep. He began crying over his sinful sleep. You see, it's very clear, John Bunyan is teaching that by sinful sleep, you can lose your assurance of faith. Now, this is quite different than the modern Reformed Church. This is a man who places holiness and godliness very first on his heart. As he cries over his sinful sleep, he's saying, "O wretched man that I am, that I should sleep in the daytime, that I should sleep in the midst of difficulty, that I should so indulge the flesh as to use that rest to ease my flesh, which the Lord of the hill intended only for the relief of the spirits of pilgrims." In other words, that arbor had not been built as an escape back to the world. It had been built for men and women to refresh their spirits in Jesus. He says, "How many steps have I taken in vain? This is what happened to Israel for their sin. They were sent back again by the way of the Red Sea. I am now retracing those steps with sorrow that I might have traveled with delight had it not been for this sinful sleep." You recognize that he's saying the same thing has happened to me as happened to the children of Israel. Now, what happened to the children of Israel? They were blocked from entering Canaan land, and they were sentenced to death in the desert. In other words, they lost their salvation. They were not allowed to enter the promised land, which is the allegorical meaning for heaven. Even today, we speak freely about heaven being the Canaan land. We speak about crossing the Jordan, meaning when we die in our physical bodies, we cross over the Jordan to the promised land. The children of Israel were forbidden from crossing over, and so they were lost. They lost their salvation. So he's saying, how far I might have been on my way by this time. I am forced to retrace those steps three times over that I should have traveled only once. Now I'm about to enter the darkness of night, for the day is almost over. Oh, that I had not slept. Christian sat down in the arbor and wept. For at last, looking sorrowfully down under the seat, he spied his scroll. With trembling and haste, he snatched it up and he put it in his coat. No one could have been more joyful than this man after he retrieved his scroll. The scroll was the assurance of his life. and acceptance at the celestial city. He lost his assurance of salvation. This is the teaching of John Bunyan, a Reformed Baptist. Now, I want to assure you, John Bunyan has been respected for years among Christian pastors and members, and he is teaching directly in line with the Word of God. By our sin, we can lose our assurance of salvation, and we are then required to take those backward steps, repenting of our sin, once more being washed by the blood. I'm not suggesting that if a person sins once, they have lost their salvation. It's very clear if you go to the book, and I'll turn quickly there for you. If you go to the book of 1 John, let me read just a couple of things for you. I pray that this will be very encouraging to your heart. Verse 9, if we confess our sins, he is faithful and just and will forgive us our sins and purify us from all unrighteousness. If we claim we have not sinned, we make him out to be a liar, and his word is not in us. He's not speaking here, if you read the context carefully, about Christians. Or verse 8, if we claim to be without sin, we deceive ourselves and the truth is not in us. Read carefully the context. This is in reference to a person before they have come to Jesus. But after the person comes to Jesus, the couplet is very clear. If we confess our sins, he's faithful and just. And then he says, my dear children, chapter 2, verse 1, I write this to you so that you will not sin. But if anybody does sin, I could paraphrase it by saying, but if perchance Satan speaks to you in a manner that causes you to forget your standing in Christ and you sin against him. And by the way, this happens to me. Sometimes a person will say something to me and the response out of my heart is not a godly response. I have to repent of that. It doesn't mean I've lost my salvation. I write this to you so that you will not sin. But if anybody does sin, we have an advocate with the Father, Jesus Christ, the righteous one. He is the atoning sacrifice for our sins. And I want to read for you over in chapter 3. See what great love the Father has lavished on us, that we should be called children of God. And that is what we are. The reason the world does not know us is that it did not know him. Dear friends, now we are children of God, and what we will be has not yet been made known. But we know that when Christ appears, we shall be like him, for we shall see him as he is. All who have this hope in him purify themselves just as he is pure. Everyone who sins breaks the law. In fact, sin is lawlessness or intentional rebellion against God. But you know that he appeared so that he might take away our sins. In him is no sin. No one who lives in him keeps on sinning. No one who continues to sin has either seen him or known him. Dear children, do not let anyone lead you astray. The one who does what is right is righteous, or dikaiosune, innocent, just as he is righteous. The one who does what is sinful is of the devil, because the devil has been sinning from the beginning. The reason the Son of God appeared was to destroy the devil's work. No one who is born of God will continue to sin because God's seed remains in them. They cannot go on sinning because they have been born of God. This is how we know who the children of God are and who the children of the devil are. anyone who does not do what is right is not God's child, nor is anyone who does not love their brother and their sister. Now, let's just take this scripture for what it says. If you are continuing to walk in sin in your life, you do not know Jesus Christ. Now, you may have all the theology that you think is correct, but you don't know Jesus. And on that great day, he's going to say to you, "Depart from me, you worker of iniquity. I don't know you, because you continue to walk in your sin." On this journey, we will make mistakes. On this journey, the infirmity of our bodies and our minds will cause us at times to not be able to do or be all that we desire to do or be. That's not sin. Sin, according to Scripture, is lawlessness. It is volitional rebellion against God. It is a voluntary act. Sin is never an accident. It is something we give ourselves to. And if you are giving yourself today to sin, you still don't know Jesus. The purpose for my coming to this broadcast is that you might know Jesus, that you might know Jesus as your crucified Lord, as your Redeemer, as the risen Christ, that you could be born again of the Spirit, that you could be washed in the blood of Jesus, and that you could be made clean before him, that you would walk in joy, that you would walk in the pleasure of Jesus. Heaven for me has already started. The fulfillment will not be until I cross over into Cana land, but for me the joy of being a child of God, that's heaven. Walking clean before God without sin, that's heaven. That's the joy of walking in Jesus Christ. You can walk that way. That's how I walk, and I'm not any different than you are. It simply means you have to be crucified with Christ. You have to give up your life here. You have to give up your pride. You have to give up your life. And you have to go on the journey. The journey to heaven. It will absorb your finest thoughts. It will absorb your finest energies. It will consume your whole world. You will not have time for the things of wickedness. You will not have time for the things of darkness. You will go to the job that Jesus has given you to do, through which he will flow resources to cover the expenses for the journey. And you will go there with joy, with an uplifted heart, to serve whomever there desires your service. You will go there to testify that Jesus is the Christ, the Son of the living God. You will not participate in lying or cheating or stealing. You will be a Daniel in the middle of Babylon. Doesn't matter to me whether you're working at the IRS or the Pentagon or Congress or the White House or an office building, or you're a janitor or a mechanic, a carpenter or an electrician. It doesn't matter whether you're a car jockey or a camel jockey. It only matters whether you have been crucified with Christ and you're on your way to heaven and the joy of Jesus fills your heart. And the pleasure of serving him absorbs every thinking, aware moment of your heart and your life. And so you go to that job not to earn money. He said, "Seek ye first the kingdom of God and his righteousness, and all of these things would be given unto you." So you go to that job to represent Jesus Christ. You don't go there to have a bad attitude. You don't go there to grumble. You don't go there to undercut. You go there to support your boss and make him look good or make her look good. You go there to serve with humility. You go there to use all the talents that Jesus has given you, being the very best you can be in the kingdom of Jesus Christ. If you're faithful in a few things, you'll be given much. Today I'm trying to be faithful in a few things and speak an honest word of God to your heart, to say that this journey requires sometimes that we turn back and go and find once more the assurance of our faith. Is that something you need to do? You're welcome to call 877-534-0780. I'm not going to take calls to argue. I'm not going to take calls to debate what I'm saying. I've paid for this time by the grace of Jesus Christ. It's His time. It's His money. And so I'm here to talk about the real questions of life. Have you been crucified with Christ? Do you live a life of victory, or are you still walking in rebellion and sin against the Most High God? Those are the vital questions, and they're the only ones I'm interested in. I'm not interested in whether you believe in a secret rapture or an eternal security. I could care less if you believe that, except that my heart's very concerned for you regarding your salvation. I'm concerned that you'd be a Pharisee or a formalist, thinking that by being a church person and having an education in theology will somehow grant you entrance into the kingdom of God. It will not. The only thing that will grant you entrance into the kingdom of God is if you have repented of your sins, been crucified with Christ, and now walk in the fullness of Jesus, filled with His Holy Spirit. Then you're bound for the holy city. That's what we need to talk about. So, at the direction of Jesus, I've set the agenda for this broadcast. I'm not going to vary from it. I'm concerned about those of you who are living, walking in brokenness before God. You're walking in sin. You're caught in drugs. You're caught in alcohol. You're caught in fornication. You're living with somebody you're not married to. I'm concerned about those of you who walk in pride and arrogance. I'm concerned about those of you who are fighting with your wife and you don't see any way to save your marriage. I'm concerned about you if you're walking in any way in destruction, and I'm inviting you to turn to Jesus today, to follow after Jesus and discover the glorious truth that Jesus is Lord, to discover the glorious truth that you can be free of sin, that the blood of Jesus has the power to break every bondage and set you free. That to me is the gospel. That's the good news of Jesus Christ. So we find Christian in the arbor, once more receiving the assurance of his salvation. And now he begins climbing back up that long mountain of difficulty, retracing his steps, eager once more to be back on the path. It's the darkness of night. Now I want to tell you, when you have repented of your sin and you have once more received the glorious reassurance of Jesus by faith, you may have to walk in the dark for a while. One young man has walked continually in fornication, coming to Christ, receiving forgiveness, and then turning once more back to wild living and fornication. His heart filled with lust. I saw him this last Sunday. His face was downcast. He was heavy burdened. I said, "Are you walking clean with Jesus?" "Yes, Pastor, I am. But it's a hard mountain I'm having to go up." I said, "Be encouraged. Jesus loves you." Now, I have to tell you the truth. This is about the journey. When you have sinned repeatedly against Jesus, and you finally come to a place where you say, okay, enough, I'm done with this. I renounce my sin, and I'm going to get back on the path. For a time, that path will be very steep, and it will be very dark. It's going to be very steep and very dark because there is a great threat that you will go back to your wickedness. One brother said to me, Pastor, how can I be certain I'm not going to go back to this wickedness? I said, you can be certain you will not go back to that wickedness, even though you're having to walk forward and climb the mountain in the dark. You can be very sure if you keep your eyes on Jesus and you keep the assurance of his forgiveness in your heart, you will not go back to that wickedness. What will cause you to go back to that wickedness if you find a comfortable place and you go to sleep and you turn your attention back to the world? One young man who told me this last weekend, he went back to the lounge because he wanted the band and he wanted the music and he wanted the dance and the girls. I said, be careful, you're on dangerous ground, you're on the devil's ground, he's a roaring lion. You must overcome him or he will devour you and you will be back in your sin of fornication and drinking. And you will be swept away and you will be lost. Do not go there again. It is sinking sand. It will not satisfy the heart cry for Jesus. I'm sure this week he's walking, struggling, climbing up that mountain. I'm sure he's having a hard time. I've called and encouraged. But this is a walk that essentially we can be encouraged by others, but each of us has to take the walk by ourselves. It's a decision we have to make. And I just want to stop for a moment and say, I believe some of you are waking up. And I believe that some of you have conviction in your heart. I believe by the Spirit that He is doing a work in your soul right now. And some of you are sick of your life of sin. And you listen to this broadcast because there is a cry in your heart that you could be delivered from your wickedness and the wicked lifestyle. If that's where you're at today, would you call me? Would you allow me the privilege of praying with you? My number is 877-534-0780. Are you tired? Are you sick of your life of sin? One beautiful woman, young woman, came walking into the National Prayer Chapel one Tuesday evening. And she said, I'm tired of my sin. Could I be born again? And oh, what joy it was to my heart. Yes, you can be born again. We prayed over her. She was radically transformed into a new creature in Christ. Oh, she's had a steep climb up that hard hill. She's climbed in the light. And she's walking in Jesus. And she's not walking in any sin today. She's walking by faith in the blood of Jesus Christ, cleansed, washed, changed, renewed, restored. You can do the same. 877-534-0780. We have time for just a couple of quick calls. HP, welcome. What would you like to share?
Well, I just want to return back to Christ and know that I am crucified with Him.
HP, would you pray and then I'll pray?
Father God, Abba, Father, I really want to come back to you and be really content and back home with you.
Lord, I pray for HP. I know that he has some temptations, some things in his life that are pulling him away from you. Lord, I ask that you give him the courage to cut them off now by the power of your blood. Lord, he keeps getting sucked back into television. He keeps getting sucked back into things that totally turn his attention from you. Lord, would you come now and meet him? Would you put your arms around HP and would you draw
yes.
him into your heart?
Yes.
Lord, would he see you as the crucified Lord and the risen Lord? Would he see that you love him with such tenderness
mm-hmm.
and such mercy
Amen.
That you don't want to see him go to hell? That all of heaven has been made available to HP to turn to you
mm-hmm.
and to have that assurance in his heart that he's walking clean before you.
Yes.
That he doesn't have to go back to these old things, these old habits, these old ways. That he doesn't have to go back to these things, Jesus. Lord, thank you for my dear brother today.
Thank you.
I just ask that you would surround him with your mercy and your love and your grace.
Mercy, love, and grace.
Thank you, Jesus. I pray in your holy name. Amen.
Amen. Thank you. I'll be in touch.
God bless you, my brother. I love you. Our phone number is 877-534-0780. Are there chains that hold you today? We have time for one more quick call. Are there chains that hold you today? I know in the spirit many of you who are listening have not yet really awakened to the condition of your soul before God. You still think you're okay. You still think you're on the road. You think your theology is going to save you. It's not going to save you. You think your church attendance is going to save you. It's not going to save you. Only being crucified with Christ and being born again, receiving the righteousness of Christ, that alone can save you. The blood of Jesus is the only thing that can set you free and save your soul. I just ask today, would you allow the Holy Spirit to awaken you to your condition before God? Would you allow him to use your conscience to awaken you from the lukewarm slumber? If you're cold of heart today or lukewarm, the Holy Spirit is waiting. He wants to set your heart on fire with love for Jesus. What is your condition? Be honest with me. Are you a cultural Christian? Are you a Pharisee? Are you a formalist? Or are you a born-again Christian, filled with the Spirit of the living God, not walking in any known sin or any rebellion against God, walking clean by his grace? What is your condition today? Where have you come from? Where are you going? I'd like to share with you just some information that will be helpful. My name is Ray Greenley. I pastor the National Prayer Chapel in Woodbridge, Virginia. You're welcome to come worship together with us. If you're hungry for Jesus, if you're tired, sick and tired of your sin, then come to the National Prayer Chapel. We meet at the All Saints Anglican Church in Woodbridge, Virginia. It's on Gideon Drive. The address is 14851 Gideon Drive, Woodbridge, Virginia. Go to our webpage. We're streaming there live. You can find us at nationalprayerchapel.com. One word, nationalprayerchapel.com. I also would like to give you our mailing address. I'd like to hear from some of you. I need very much that encouragement from your heart. The National Prayer Chapel, Post Office Box 2346, Woodbridge, Virginia, 22195. That's the National Prayer Chapel, Post Office Box 2346, Woodbridge, Virginia, 22195. Now let's pray together. O King of Kings and Lord of Lords, my Father, Jesus, I cry aloud to you today for each person listening to this broadcast. I ask, Lord, for those who are sick of their sin, who are tired, who somehow believe they can never make the break, they can never be released. Lord, I ask that you would encourage their hearts, that you would awaken them to their dire condition and cause them to run to the cross, that they would be crucified with you, that they would repent of their sin, that they would do business with you, Almighty God of heaven. Cause men and women right now, wherever they're at, to stop and just begin to pray and confess their sin. Lord, cause them to repent now. And Lord, those who are struggling, they have repented of their sin and they're now struggling up this hill of difficulty and it's dark and they don't have confidence they can make it. Would you strengthen them by your Spirit? Would you breathe into them now the Spirit of the living God? Strengthen them in this determination that they will walk clean before you. Lord, send forth your Holy Spirit and your love. In the name of Jesus, I pray. Amen. God bless you. I'll talk to you soon.